Guys, thank you so much for joining us today. Before we get started, I just want to take a moment to express that I personally am thinking of everything that's happening in our country right now, about the families and the people who are in pain, the Black Lives Matter movement, and I just want to reiterate that anything that's said here is reflective of our own personal views, and that that's okay. This is an open forum for everybody, and feel free to listen and speak in any way that you want, respectfully, of course. I just wanted to take a moment and say that before we get started. I think the music that Dan has selected today will help us get through it today and maybe take a moment and listen and appreciate the people who we have built our organization on. So with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Sean to play Dan's class, and then we'll turn it over to Dan to do some more speaking and to answer any questions. Please bear with us because the video is a bit laggy, but you can probably hear the music and see some of the album images all right. But please shoot me a comment if you're having trouble. All right, so you can give it a go. All right, we're not getting sound. One more thing, one more try, and then I'll try it on my end if not.
Okay. Dan Nimmer, the pianist with the Jazz and Lincoln Center Orchestra, and I want to thank you all for joining me today for Volume 2 of my virtual record listening session. Now, here's that same photo that I showed in my previous masterclass of my music collection in my apartment here in New York City. And as you can see, we love the music in this house. Recordings allow us to obtain a wealth of information, and they really are the next best thing to hearing an actual live performance or taking a lesson from a master of our music. Records serve as a documentation of jazz's entire recorded history, and we must listen, analyze, study, and appreciate them in order to be able to speak the vocabulary of this music authentically while developing our own original voice. Today, I'll be talking about some of my favorite records. Now, trying to make a list about anything in this music and then narrowing it down to a list of favorites is an almost impossible task. That's why today I'll be focusing on piano players, and even more specifically, piano trio records that represent the players that really got me hooked on this music when I was first starting out. In the first edition of this masterclass series, I talked about seven pianists and their records that influenced me. We talked about Oscar Peterson, Wynton Kelly, Bill Evans, Errol Garner, Rhett Garland, Ahmad Jamal, and Hank Jones. Today, I want to explore seven more of the great pianists that have influenced me. Although the albums that I've chosen for the subject today do represent a certain era of the music, it's important to study the whole history of this music. So with all that being said, I really hope that you do enjoy this virtual listening session. Let's talk about the great jazz pianist Phineas Newborn Jr. He was from Tennessee and is an important part of Memphis's rich jazz history that produced so many greats like George Coleman, Harold Mayburn, Hank Crawford, Frank Strozier, the great Booker Little, Jamil Nasser, and so many more. Phineas had an incredible mind and had complete technical control over the piano. This record right here is one of my all-time favorites. It's called A World of Piano. It was recorded in 1961 and features two of the finest rhythm sections of all time. The A side has Paul Chambers and Philly Joe Jones, while the B side has Sam Jones and Lewis Hayes. We're going to take a listen to the first song on the A side, which is Charlie Parker's Cheryl. Now I want you to listen for Phineas' iconic opening of his solo, where his right hand is playing one idea while the left hand plays a completely different idea at the same time. Let me tell you, that's not easy at all. He also shows us his unique style of block chord playing and double hand soloing here. Let's take a listen to the incredible Phineas Newborn Jr. Bobby Timmons was from Philadelphia and is without a doubt one of the funkiest, hardest swinging piano players of all time. He's known for his work with Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers and recorded a bunch of great albums as a leader that have become classics. This is the trio in person, live at the Village Vanguard, recorded in 1961 for Riverside Records. It features Ron Carter on bass and Albert Tootie Heath on drums. Let's check out Autumn Leaves, Bobby Timmons Trio. Thank you. Continuing with the theme of hard-swinging piano players, we gotta talk about the great Cedar Walt. Just like Bobby Timmons, Cedar spent a lot of time playing and recording with Art Blakey. Now, Cedar had everything, an incredible feel, sophisticated harmony, and a playing style that was completely his own. He also wrote so many great songs that have become standards for us. This comes from a 1973 live concert at a club called Boomers in New York City with Clifford Jordan, Sam Jones, and Louis Hayes. Let's hear the trio playing Burt Bacharach's This Guy's in Love with You. Cedar Walton. Tommy Flanagan is one of the many incredible jazz musicians to come out of Detroit, Michigan. To me, his playing represents elegance. Tommy is very well documented both as a sideman and a leader, and happens to be on two landmark saxophone recordings, Sonny Rollins' Saxophone Colossus and John Coltrane's Giant Steps. This is Tommy Flanagan's Overseas album from 1957 with Wilbur Little on bass and some of the most incredible brush playing by the great Elvin Jones. Let's check out Relaxin' at Camarillo, Tommy Flanagan. Thelonious Monk was a genius and an innovator. He taught us all that being yourself in this music is the most honest and the most important thing to do. Monk wrote about 70 songs, and every single one of them is a masterpiece. Now, I'm breaking the rules just a little bit by not having a piano trio record, but I couldn't help it. This is such a great one. This is Monk with Coltrane, Wilbur Ware, Shadow Wilson from 1957. Let's check out Trinkle Tinkle. Thank you. If we're talking about innovators, then we also have to talk about the great Bud Powell. Like Monk, Bud was crucial to the development of the new sound of jazz piano and bebop. His harmonies, his lines, and his approach influenced countless musicians. Let's take a listen to this classic, The Amazing Bud Powell, Volume 2, from 1953 with George DeVivier and Art Taylor. This is Glass Enclosure. Barry Harris is another one of the many jazz masters to come out of Detroit. He's a torchbearer of bebop and he's a worldwide treasure. This record is one of my favorites and it's an iconic piano trio record. This is Barry Harris live at the Jazz Workshop in San Francisco from 1960 and features Sam Jones and Louis Hayes. Let's hear Barry playing Lolita, and I want you to check out his incredible solo break. That break alone is worth the price of the record. Barry Harris. Thank you. I want to thank you all for joining me and for checking out some of my favorite recordings. I'm really hoping that you enjoyed hearing all of these great jazz masters, and I'm wishing you all happy listening.
Awesome. All right, guys. For those of you just joining us, my name is Chloe. I'm the video editor here at Jazz at Lincoln Center. I'm happy to be hosting this masterclass today. That was a masterclass by Dan Nimmer, a pianist for the Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra, brought to you by us, Jazz at Lincoln Center in New York City. Dan is joining us now in just a minute to start answering questions from all of you. I just want to thank all of you for being here, for your constant support. You've heard me say it time and time again, but we wouldn't be here without you. Your support means so much to us here at Jazz at Lincoln Center. So if you do have a question for Dan, please use the raise hand function here in Zoom. Click the participants tab on the bottom of your Zoom window and then press the raise hand button to ask a question. You can also feel free to use the chat feature here in Zoom, shoot me a message. I'll open that up publicly actually now. So feel free to throw your question in that chat. And if you're watching on Facebook, I'll also be monitoring the comment section there. So feel free to post your question there as well. I'm gonna turn it over to Dan to say hello while you are all gathering your courage to ask questions and enjoy.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for tuning in. I'm really happy to be here with you all today to talk about jazz records. They're super important to me. As they should be. They serve as our knowledge base for this music, for the vocabulary of this music that we call jazz music. I'd love to hear some of your questions about the records, about the music, about piano, just really about anything that you might have questions about. So I want to thank you all. I want to thank Jazz at Lincoln Center, Chloe and Seton, and everyone at Jazz at Lincoln Center. So thank you so much. And look forward to answering some of your questions.
Awesome. Okay, great. We have a first question from Peter Maltese.
All right, Peter.
There you are. Hey, Peter.
Hi. Hi there. Dan, thank you for sharing your music. And I wanted to say I enjoyed looking at the graphics of the albums as much as the music. So I wanted to ask you, what comes to mind is your favorite album graphics, of any genre, but of course jazz too.
That's a great question. I mean, that's the thing with LPs and with vinyl, that it's one of the main points that I love to have them up on my shelf so I can actually look at them and read the liner notes. That's something that we've lost. Even with having a CD and now with streaming, which is great. Streaming is great for people to understand and learn the music and to have a vast access to music. But when you have that LP, when you're looking at the picture, when you're looking at Oscar Peterson, when you're looking at Wynton Kelly, and you see them up close, you can read the liner notes, that brings a whole nother story to the music. I enjoy all of the Blue Note covers. I always thought when I was growing up, those were cool, and they had like a aesthetic vibe that I liked visually. All the photographers that worked on those. But as far as a favorite, I don't really have a favorite. It's really hard for me. Like I said, it's really hard for me to pick a favorite. What's a good album cover? Maybe. Yeah, I like that Bobby Timmons trio picture just because it's the three of them, Ron, Tootie, and Bobby Timmons, obviously. I just like the vibe they're on. I like to see the people's expressions. I like to see, you know, the environment they're in, the what kind of piano they had. A lot of the studio photos too, made it on the back of albums. We don't always get to see those. So it's always a great thing for me to look at those. Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Thanks, Peter. All right, the next question comes from Marcy Bell. Hello, Marcy.
Thank you. I'm sorry I didn't listen to the first one because you may have answered this question, but I'm concerned about players' use of block chords, and it seems like most of them did that. Could you clarify that for me?
Yeah, I mean, I've adapted my own way of playing block chords based on a lot of the great players, the masters of our music. So if you listen to even the stride piano players, Art Tatum, they're playing block chords in a different way. James P. Johnson, you go way far back. But I was more attracted to, when I was first starting, was the music in this era, the late 50s through the mid 60s, and those players, Red Garland, Oscar Peterson, Phineas Newborn, Errol Garner, they all had a way of playing block chords that was different, George Shearing. So I took from the best and I made it into my own sound. So it's basically block chords is having an octave and then filling in notes like you would in on a big band, if you guys aren't piano players or musicians listening. And that's something that creates the effect of like a saxophone section or a trumpet section, to have those kind of voicings stacked like that. And people did it differently. People had multiple ways of playing, like motions inside of the chord. Some people had more static voicings. And there's so many different ways to do it. So I particularly like all of those people. Phineas Newborn was one of the greatest at it, just because of the sheer speed and dexterity he had. On the track I played, he didn't get to a lot of the crazy block chords. He does block chords at amazing speeds. It's really unbelievable. So that's just a thing that a lot of the piano players have done in the history of our music. And it's just one of the sounds of piano playing. And I enjoy it. Does that answer your question, or did you have a more specific?
Are the right hands and left hand basically doing the same thing?
Well, there's different ways to do it. So the way I do it is I always start, when I talk to students about doing it, is I start with the octave. That's the most important thing. And I'm not always playing the melody in the left hand. Sometimes I'm playing a supporting harmony chord in the left hand, like something like Red Garland would do, to create an effect of having like a trombone section mixed with a saxophone section or a trumpet section. So in other words, not necessarily rhythmically, usually. So rhythmically, I would play the same rhythm, but the left hand might stay in one position while the right hand moves according to the melody line. So it depends. But then you can get into more advanced stuff like Phineas would do. He would play double hand piano lines with block chords. So that adds a whole nother element. But generally I would say the left hand and the right hand are doing rhythmically the same thing, but not necessarily melodically the same thing.
Hey Dan, we have a couple requests to maybe show us on the piano what a block chord is. Sorry to put on the spot, but
it's okay. I don't know.
Since you have one right there.
Okay. I don't know if I can. All right. Let me see if I can get the.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Perfect. So a block chord would be, if you had a melody, let's say Honeysuckle Rose, and you're just playing the melody. That's a single line melody. When you start adding an octave, it's not quite a block chord yet, but you have a bigger sound. You have an octave. You have the root. You have the melody doubled in the right hand. Playing a block chord, you would have inner voicings, and you could do whatever you want. You might start out with, so that's just basic. Errol Garner. So it's just adding different harmony notes inside of just the octave. Instead of playing, you get, and there's all kinds of filler notes you can put in there depending on where you want to take it. So if I'm playing just a solo on that, I could play there's a million different ways to do it. It's just adding more texture and more sound to an already established melody. It fills out the chord more.
Awesome. Thanks for your question, Marcy, and to the people on Facebook asking for the demonstration. Thank you for asking as well. Amazing. I am going to throw it over to the next question from Mike Seitz.
Mike, all right.
Hey, Mike.
Hi, Dan.
Hey, Mike.
Hey, a question about your span in your hands and how that affects the voicing. Like, I know a lot of pianists are lucky to get an octave, but some of us can play consecutive tenths in both hands, and that really makes a big difference in the way we voice things. Can you give me some insight in how that affects your play?
Yeah, of course. I always say this, not with caution, but like I've had students in the past that necessarily wouldn't have a big span, especially in the left hand. I feel like it matters, not matters, but people seem to be affected by it more. Not being able to reach a tenth, and they get a little discouraged, and because that's kind of a sound to be able to play, you know, tenth and moving lines. So there's ways to get around it. There's ways to roll chords and stuff like that. But that being said, I can reach about from C to F sharp if I'm lucky. But usually on a good day, it's just C to F. G to C, but with playing filler notes. So yeah,
Yeah.
And the right hand is a little, just because of the way playing like stride piano and stretching your hand, it gets different. You'll notice even all the pianists, 99% of pianists will tell you that your left hand over time becomes more stretched out than your right hand. So it's just a little bit. I can reach the same notes in the right hand, but I have more control over the reach in the left hand. So yeah, C to F comfortably, I would say. But yeah, it's there's ways to get around it. There's ways to get around it if you don't have a tenth rolling the notes and stuff like that. But it's a great question. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. All right, the next question is going to come from Tyler Bullock.
All right, Tyler.
Hey, Tyler.
Hey, I just wanted to ask, so you were mentioning some of the piano players like Barry Harris is from Detroit. I think Phineas Newborn is from Memphis.
Memphis, yeah.
How do their environments that they're raised in or where they come from affect their playing or their inspiration?
Mm-hmm. Great question. So there's all kinds of regional sounds that you hear. And a lot of times that gets put into East Coast versus West Coast, which is, there is that element. But a lot of times, oh my God.
We can still hear you.
Okay. I got a phone call coming in. Sorry about that. I thought I disabled it. Can you see me still?
Yeah.
Okay. So East Coast versus West Coast is one of the regional differences. But in between that, in between coast to coast, there's all kinds of pockets. There's the Midwest sound. And you have to realize that those things happen during the jazz age. So now it's a little different. Jazz is much more universal. And you also had the European sound coming in during those early times. So it's very important to realize the regional differences of sound, like Kansas City swing, like New York East Coast stride piano, Eastern Seaborn piano stylings, the West Coast, the cool sound, but also to realize that those aren't always correct terms to describe it. Like a lot of people would say West Coast is more laid back and cool, and it is, but it has some of the most intense. If you actually dig deep into the great West Coast players. I was just watching a video. Josh Nelson, great pianist, had John Clayton and a lot of LA based. He's been having guests on his show, and they're spinning records from the West Coast, the contemporary sound, those specific jazz records, And man, that's some of the, that music has so much fire in it that it, you would be amiss to call it, you'd be remiss to call it laid back and cool. Of course, they had that element. But yeah, the regional differences are very important where bebop came from. And even now, even though we're not in the 50s or the 60s or the 20s or the 30s, there's still pockets of sounds that happen in different parts of the country. People say you sound like you're from the Midwest as a compliment. We have a lot of hard swinging people in Chicago. I'm from Milwaukee. A lot of hard swinging people in Milwaukee too, and a long tradition of that too. So it's important to know the history of where you come from and the different pockets of music around that. So thank you for, does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. And actually, I'm from Nashville.
Oh, great.
So Phineas Newborn is also mm-hmm. from Tennessee. So that kind of, there's a connection there.
Yeah, definitely. Great.
Thanks for your Tyler. Question. All right, cool. All right, we have a question from Benjamin in the chat. Benjamin is curious about when he notices when he watches that you have a big score on your piano, and he's curious about when in that score, and I'm translating a little bit here, but when in that score you can sort of take freedom to improvise, sort of not when you're soloing, and when you're sort of following the score to a T.
Okay, well, thank you for your question. So yeah, if you're, I don't know what exact videos you're referring to, maybe like a live stream with the Jazz on Lincoln Center or maybe something else, I'm not quite sure, but I can tell you that playing with the Jazz Lincoln Center Orchestra, we have arrangements and they're written down. So I have the music out, and the music is like a roadmap for anything, especially in jazz music. So you're looking at this as a map, like where is the song going? You have written material. Sometimes you have just chord changes. Sometimes you have a lot of written material in the staff. So, and then you have different sections of the song. You have the solo section, and you have all kinds of notations, like what to play, how to play, depending on the arrangement. So it really is dependent upon what the music calls for in that moment. So playing with a big band, as a pianist, you have to find your space. I don't know what instrument you play, but you have to find your space within the arrangement to let your voice be heard. So we have to stay true to the chart, and of course we have to play the chart as it is and read all the notes, but you also have to bring your own sound. Just like with anything, you have to bring your own sound to that piece of music within the context of the style and the band you're playing in. So it depends on the song. Sometimes I could be improvising 90% of the time. Sometimes there's no improvisation. Sometimes it's just through composed. It really depends on the piece. So it's good to put yourself in a lot of those situations where there's just a lead sheet with changes, and you're responsible for making up everything. And also playing with no music. I mean, I play gigs all the time, not necessarily with a big band because we need to have arrangements, but I play gigs all the time in clubs. I did a lot when I was growing up too, where people just called songs, and you had to know the song. If you didn't know it, you say, I don't know it, you move on. But in that situation, you're improvising the whole time, basically based on the harmony of the song and based on the tradition of that song, based on the lyrics of that song, you name it. It goes on and on. Trying to find out what the song needs in that moment from your instrument and what your role is and how do you bring your role to that piece. So yeah, it's great. It's a great question. So yeah, depends on the piece. And thank you.
Well, I'm going to actually unmute him so, because he wants to follow up. There you are. Sure.
It's sorry. I am, right. My question is because I am pianist, and this year, for example, I was playing in the piano, but I have the score, and mm-hmm. I understand, like you are saying, it's important to have the score and the structure to improvise or to follow it. But for example, I noticed that my teacher, for example, wait everything. And I think it's a bit frustrating, I have to say anyway. And this was my question. If you, for example, have the score and you have the American encryption, but you are doing new things if you consider necessary, for example. So yes, okay, that was my question. My English.
Oh no, it's okay. So yeah, I think maybe to get more specific, I think you're asking about, you said your teacher a lot of times writes everything in,
yes,
for you to play. So I think that's good too, because if you're, I don't know what level you are at, but maybe the teacher is giving you examples and material to play so that later on you're able to improvise and make up your own part. But the main thing is really to be, in order to improvise, first of all, you have to free your mind. You have to be very creative, and everyone has that. So everyone has to be able to relax and try to play what you feel in the moment. But the thing that's important and often overlooked is that we have to study the masters of this music first. So we have to listen, and we have to take from them, we have to transcribe, we have to write down or memorize other people's solos. And that's really the only way to get ahead in improvising authentically, I think, is to listen to the masters.
So the main idea is not to disturbate the orchestra or the instrument who is playing in that moment, but maybe to and I don't know, yes, that seems. Mm-hmm. And thanks very much.
Oh yeah, yeah. So yeah, I think the main goal is to figure out what role you play inside of that song. So, and I think you said not to get in the way. That's, yeah, there's a give and take between the musicians. So we have to understand where is your place in the space. Where should I not play? A lot of times piano is not playing, especially in big band. So just keep that in mind. Thank you so much for your question.
Thanks, Benjamin. Okay, so we have time for a couple more questions, but okay, Before we get to those, I just want to make sure you guys join us again. I love seeing these familiar faces. We have a bunch more live events coming up every day throughout the coming weeks, more masterclasses, more conversations with members of the JLCO Center Orchestra, with Wynton. We've got live performances on all the JLCO Center pages and more. Our next masterclass on Wednesday is gonna be with Walter Blanding, saxophonist for the JLCO Center Orchestra. We had previously announced this class a couple of weeks ago, but due to some scheduling conflicts, we had to reschedule. But it should be worth the wait, and Walter is gonna go over his practicing process and provide insight into developing your own sound and your own voice. That'll be this Wednesday, June 3rd, at this very same time here on Zoom and also on Facebook. You can always keep track of our calendar on at jazz.org on our website. And then next week is very exciting. It's our first ever virtual Essentially Ellington jazz band competition and festival. This is a huge week every year for us at Jazz at Lincoln Center, and it unfortunately had to be canceled, but we are now moving it online to be a virtual festival. It should be a really exciting week. We have an At Home with EE alumni concert, we have a composition and arranging class with Ted Nash, and we have band performances from our 18 finalist bands and 5 international bands. These kids are all so talented, and they deserve an audience, so please come back next week and check out what they can do and help us give them the support that they deserve. The last thing I'll say is, if it's within your means, please consider making a donation to Jazz at Lincoln Center. We are a nonprofit organization, and we are committed to entertaining, enriching, educating, and expanding our global community for jazz. We're so grateful for contributions of any amount, and to our supporters and donors, we cannot thank you enough. Okay, that's all I'll say. And I'm gonna turn it over to, Yulia has a question in the chat for you, Dan. She wants to know, okay, any advice on improving one's sight reading and practicing at home?
Okay, Yulia, thank you so much. Great question. Yes, and the one answer I could say for that is, you have to just keep doing it. You have to challenge yourself. I was not always the best reader coming to New York. I learned a little differently. I played classical music, but I wasn't as serious as I hoped I would have been back then. I wish I would have been back then. So now I consider myself to be a pretty good reader, and that's because I've had many, many experiences and been thrown into the fire many times on gigs, at rehearsals. And piano is tricky for that, because a lot of times our parts can be very bare or not have a lot of written notes, but sometimes it can look like some Scriabin, like it can look like Rachmaninoff. I mean, not that intense, but it can be daunting sometimes to get a new piece of music and at a rehearsal and be like, how am I gonna survive this? So there's ways to do it. You can practice every day. I used to just open up a book, even if it was not that hard, like a prelude or something, not crazy. This is when I was younger, and just try to go through stuff. See if you can make it through to the end. You're going to have mistakes no matter what. There's no getting around it, but the only way to get better is to keep trying, and your brain and your eyes get used to seeing stuff. So muscle memory comes into play. All that kind of stuff, reading, trying to sight read rhythms, as opposed to work on rhythms as opposed to reading the actual notes. Those are the same thing, but they're also separate. So the only way to get better at it is to challenge yourself. Even with the few students that I have now, I try to bring in something once in a while, especially if it's someone that I know wants to improve their sight reading, and that might be something that's holding them back. You know, there's all kinds of levels of musicians. There's people that need to work on sight reading but are incredible improvisers. But then there's people that are incredible readers, incredible sight readers, writers, but they need to work on getting a sound or improvising or getting more vocabulary. So I try to figure out what that person needs. And bring in something and say, try this, let's go through this. And a lot of times they'll be hesitant because they know they're not gonna be able to get through it. It's just not their thing. So, but after a while, they realize that it's important to have that and to keep trying, even though if you know you're gonna fail at first. That's the only way to get better, is to push through that barrier that you have. It's a lot of it's mental too, it's in your mind. Saying I can't do this, or giving up before you even give yourself a chance to try or to get better. So you need to try to put yourself in a situation where you're going to have to sight read more often. Even if on the gigs you're always prepared, you still need to try to work on it at home. Just open any kind of classical music, even a transcription, and try to see if you can make it through. There's also tips about how to glance. You get better and better at this every time you do it, but to glance, like if you're in a big band rehearsal and you get a piece of music and you look at it, there's no way I'm gonna hit all these notes. Look for key points in the arrangement or the song that you know that if I hear this or if I get this, I'm not gonna totally mess everyone else up. piano is tricky. So we have to look for those key points, those key elements, figure out if you can maybe leave out a few voices at first, if there's chords that are voiced out with all kinds of clusters or stuff that's not as familiar to you, see if you can weed out that stuff and just get to the core of what you think is important. So you can make it to the finish line, you can go to the end of the song and be successful. So yeah, that's a great question. That's something that never stops. You never stop learning how to sight read. You can just keep getting better and better. Some people are just made for that. They have the brain for that. The great late Kenny Drew Jr., Kenny Drew's son, had a special ability for reading. Apparently, you could just put anything in front of him, a piece of classical music he's never seen before, and he would be able to read pretty much flawlessly. And that's a whole different skill. That's you know, that's something special. That's different. That's I envy those people. But there's ways to work on it. And I'm an example of someone who's worked on it, and I'm still trying to get better at it. So it's possible to do. Thank you.
Awesome. Okay, let's take one more. Dan, I encourage you to maybe scroll through the Facebook after this. There's some good questions on there, and sure. I wish we could get to all of them. But
yeah.
We'll take this last one from Dominic, and then
all right.
Maybe you can hop on there if you have time.
Sounds good.
Look through. All right, Dominic, go ahead. What's your question?
Hey, Dan. Good evening.
Hey, Dominic.
I've got a question, a second question to the block chords. I saw in a concert from you in Luxembourg that you flip your fingers in the inside when you play fast or slower lines, in general lines. And I thought, is it a system or is it out of your intuition? Because I tried it and it sounds sometimes horrible. And so I thought about, is it a special system or only do you only flip the fingers in the inside?
Yeah, thank you. I get this question a lot. This is about what Dominic's referring to, is the block chords where I play with an octave and then try to curl my fingers under to get kind of a swish sound like you would get on an organ. And the reason that I do that is there's a few other piano players that I've known that have done that, one being Benny Green. I never actually saw him do it, but there is a video somewhere out there of him doing it. But the reason that I do it sometimes, I don't do it all the time, but it's because I'm trying to emulate or trying to get close to the feeling and the sound of the great Errol Garner. And so if you see videos of Errol Garner playing, he had big hands and he was able to get this sound. It sounded like a swishing sound, like on an organ, where he almost sounds like he's bending notes on the piano with the block chords, but he was able to use the tips of his fingers. There's many videos of Errol Garner in the 60s and all the way through the 60s. I was trying to emulate that sound, but I couldn't get it with playing like that. So one day I started curling the fingers up on the tips, and I was able to get kind of a warmer sound in between the sound of Errol Garner and trying to emulate other great piano players too. So it's just a kind of a developed technique that I've figured out. It's not for everyone, maybe something unique, but that's the general sound that I was going for. And as far as putting the notes inside, certain keys are easier to do that. Obviously you can't swish up to a sharp key. It's much trickier. It's easier to go from a black key to a white key. So that kind of stuff is good to take into consideration. If you want to try to get better at it, I would recommend, I always tell people to relax no matter what style they're playing. So you have to relax your arm. You have to not attack the piano. You want to play into the instrument. You want to coax the best sound you can get out of it without trying to break the piano. Especially when you're playing block chords, you have to be relaxed. Otherwise it just sounds like a typewriter. But yeah, does that answer the question, or did you have a more specific?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Cool. Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks, Dominic. All right, guys, we got to hand over the Zoom to another class that's coming up right after this. But I just want to say thank you to everybody for joining us. Thank you to Dan. We really appreciate you guys showing up for us every day. It really means a lot. And if you want to keep track of all we're doing, please follow us on our various social media channels. Facebook, just search Jazz at Lincoln Center. And on Twitter and Instagram, we're at jazz.org, dot spelled out, D-O-T. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Dan to say goodbye, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Chloe. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. I wish you all a great week, and stay healthy, stay happy. We're going through some crazy stuff right now, so let's all stick together and make the world a better place through our music and coming together. Thank you all.
Talk to you soon. Thanks, Dan. Bye, guys. Take care, everybody.